Blessings, friends. Welcome back to High Kadosh Ministries, where holiness is a lifestyle. And Jesus Christ is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Now, we pick up in chapter 3 of 1 John this morning. And in the first two verses, we're told that we are the sons of God. In verse 2, it says, we now are the sons of God, but we do not know what we shall be. In verse 3, it says, every man that has this hope. What hope? The hope that we shall be the sons of God. Not guests, not visitors, not associates or comrades, but the very sons of God. I mean, think about it for a moment. If you knew the President of the United States, say you went to college with him, and you arrive in Washington, D.C., you're sitting in the Oval Office with the President, you're bragging about the rights that you have and the privileges that you have as his friend, and yet his son is sitting right beside you thinking, you have no clue what it means to truly belong. You may be his friend, but I'm his son. All the privileges, all the honor and dignity, all the distinct rights belong to me because I am his son. Well, friends, if you are a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ, if you have bowed your knee and surrendered to him and he is your king and your Lord, the Almighty welcomes you into the family as a son. Now that is hope beyond hope. But pick up in verse 3 again. It says, every man that has this hope in him purifies himself, even as he is pure. Now again, that word pure there indicates separation. Just as the Almighty separates himself from the things of this world, the ways of this world, the agenda of this world, so too are we to separate ourselves. And when you look at this word purifieth, when it says, he that hath this hope purifieth himself, the connotation there is the same way of that of a virgin. A virgin keeps herself pure. How? By separating herself from the male gender. She won't even allow herself to be in a compromised situation. She separates herself from that. She distances herself from that. Well, that's what this is saying here. Everyone that has this hope purifies himself as he is pure. But now this is where I want to spend the rest of our time this morning in verse number 4. Whosoever committeth sin transgresses the law. Well, what law? The law that dates all the way back to Moses. Now watch this. For sin is the transgression of the law. Sin is breaking the law. That's why we're told in the book of Romans, before the law there was no sin. It would be like driving down the Autobahn and a police officer pulling you over for going too fast. What do you mean? That doesn't make any sense whatsoever. There's no speed limit on the Autobahn. So you can't hold me accountable for something where there is no law. And that's what this says. Sin is the transgression of the law. So breaking the law of God is considered sin. Now look at verse 5. And ye know that he was manifested to take away our sins, and in him is no sin. Verse 6, whosoever abides in him, remember we've talked about that in the last few devotions, whosoever abides in him sinneth not. Now I know immediately the argument will be, well now wait a minute, we're all human, we're going to sin. But you don't have to. That's what the Word of God teaches. Romans chapter 6. How can you who are dead to sin live any longer therein? 1 John chapter 2, verse 1. My little children, these things write I unto you, that you sin not. I am writing you these promises. I'm delivering you these truths, so in hope that you would no longer sin. Stop doing what you have been freed from. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 34. Awake to righteousness, and sin not. Look at verse 9 in 1 John chapter 3. Whosoever is born of God does not commit sin, for God's seed remains in him, and he cannot sin because he is born of God. So we are told over and over and over we can live beyond sin. We can live above sin. We can live lives where we do not have to sin. Now certainly the idea here is practicing sin. Something that we knowingly do. We may plan. We may strategize. You know, I think back on King David. When King David committed his act with Bathsheba, once he realized that she was pregnant, he now had to cover his sin. Because Uriah was out on the battlefield, and there's no way the timing of it would allow Uriah to impregnate his wife. So David began to strategize, and one sin led to another sin, led to another sin. And we are cautioned not to allow such things to happen in our lives. You see, most often when we allow ourselves to fall into sin is when we've been lulled to sleep. We've sat down. We've rested. But as long as we are crisp and alert and aware, we cannot be caught off guard. We cannot be blindsided. It is when we let down our guard that we are blindsided. And so, friends, I want to encourage you, unlike what most people would tell you, don't be deceived in believing that you have to sin. Because if that's true, the Bible is the lie. Because the Bible clearly says in our text, whosoever abides in him sins not. So again, as long as we are abiding in Jesus, it's impossible for us to sin. But the moment we step out from under, we move ourselves out of Jesus, now we are capable of sinning. Think about an argument for a moment. Someone offends you. You take the humble approach, even if you're not wrong, and you apologize to them. That's abiding in Jesus Christ. The moment you step outside of Jesus Christ, now you are prone to defend yourself and to lash back at the person. That is not abiding in Jesus Christ. And when you do lash back at that person, when you do step outside of Christ, when you do begin to feel violated and assaulted, now you will be more prone to defend yourself and to act in the flesh instead of acting in the spirit. So again, let's finish this morning by looking at our text. Whosoever abides in him does not sin. Chapter 2, verse 1. My little children, these things I write unto you that you do not sin. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 34. Awake to righteousness and sin not. Romans chapter 6, verse 2. How can you who are dead to sin live any longer therein? How clear does the Bible have to present it? How many times does the Bible have to say it? The only reason we fall back on that old crutch that we have to sin because we're in the flesh is because standing guard and attention at all times is a tedious task. But that's what we've been called to do, friends. And the moment you let your guard down, you better believe you'll be in a situation that you rely on the rest of that verse in 1 John chapter 2, verse 1. If any man sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. Chapter 1, verse 9. If we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins. The moment you step in the flesh, you're sin capable. As long as you abide in Jesus Christ, you will remain sin free, friends. And if that doesn't make you want to shout hallelujah, I don't know what will. There was a time you, there was a time I, there was a time every other person who brings themselves under the banner of the Lord Jesus Christ was absolutely incapable, left on our own, to be free of sin. But now that his resurrection power lives within us, we are dead to sin to live no longer therein. I love you, friends. Now, as Yahweh wills, and until tomorrow, I'll see you on the next video.